Tourism has always been a major part of Florida's legacy, and St. Lucie County is very much part of that tradition. But have you explored all that St. Lucie County has to offer? From professional sporting events to pristine waters and secluded environmental preserves, from marine education centers and museums to diverse cultural festivals, St. Lucie County has something for everyone. So join us as we vacation in our own backyard and send you postcards from home.
Welcome to Postcards from Home, a show that highlights St. Lucie County's natural and cultural treasures. I'm your host, Erick Gill, and each month, we take a look at some of St. Lucie County's best-known parks, museums, and nature preserves, as well as highlighting some of its best-kept secrets. Today, we're going to be shining a light on Heathcote Botanical Gardens. Located in Fort Pierce off of Samana Road, Heathcote is a 3.5-acre oasis featuring hundreds of trees, plants, and flowers from exotics to natives. With unique features such as a reflection garden, the pioneer house, the herb garden, and more, Heathcote offers residents and tourists a quiet place to connect with nature. It's also home to the largest public display of tropical bonsais in the U.S. The James J. Smith Bonsai Gallery features more than 100 beautiful bonsais with more than 24 varieties. Throughout the year, Heathcote offers a wide range of activities from plant sales to children's gardening classes. So let's go meet Miriam Charles, director and head gardener here at Heathcote, who will tell us more about what's blooming. Well, Miriam, thanks for joining me here in the gardens at Heathcote. We were here a few years ago focusing on the new bonsai collection, but like any garden, it's always growing and it's always blooming. So tell us a little bit about what's new at Heathcote.
The garden that we're in right now is what we call the rainforest, and it's fairly new. It was developed about 3 or 4 years ago and opened to the public about 3 years ago.
And there's a fountain and a plaque behind us, and I think ties back to your family roots. They go deep here at Heathcote.
Yes, we have a plaque here for Gloria Moore, who is my mother. She's one of the 5 founding members of the garden, and she was into tropical plants, and so we decided to develop this garden and dedicate it to her.
So even though it's a tropical rainforest, there's none of those invasive, like those dart frogs, right, or
no.
Anything like that?
No, I don't think
not
so.
Yet.
Not yet. There
They're
could
moving
be.
Up from South Florida,
I haven't
I'm
seen
sure.
them yet, but they could be in here.
Just talk a little bit. You mentioned the origins of Heathcote. This originally was a commercial nursery, right?
Yes. The main nursery, plant nursery, was on closer to Savannah Road, and the family lived on the property in a 2-story house behind us towards the back of the property. And Molly Cremins, it was the Cremins family, and her husband were both nursery people. Molly Cremins also is the one that built the Japanese garden that we have right now, and that was part of the reason why a group of people wanted to save it, was to save that Japanese garden.
Okay.
And that's still here.
And then the property over years, you've kind of expanded a little bit, and there were talks even at one point about expanding all the way down to the Public Works compound, and is that still in the future plans?
The Public Works part is not. They're still going ahead with that, which is great. It's going to be a great recreational area close to Heathcote, so people could go to Heathcote and visit that also. We did later, I think probably early 90s, purchased the property over here behind us, which used to be a trailer park, and now we use that for our parking for our events.
Well, that was a nice segue. You mentioned the overflow parking for like your annual plant sales, and you have one coming up this month.
We have one this coming weekend, yep.
So, but what throughout the year, what are some of the big events that you all do?
Our fall festival is always the weekend before Thanksgiving. This year we're doing a very big Christmas event that we haven't done before. It's going to be bigger than anything we've ever done. We're hoping it's going to be a very good attractor to families and people that want to see Christmas lights. And then our other large event is our Bonsai Ball, and that's always sometime in the month of March.
Okay. And then in addition to that, there are all kinds of smaller events throughout the year. I know there's kids gardening classes and stuff for adults. There was Tai Chi too at one point in the gardens. Is that still going on?
Tai Chi isn't, but we do still have beginning Spanish classes that are free on Friday. We have educational classes for adults and children throughout the year. We have children's gardening after school, and different schools in the area will come here and do field trips here. We have educational classes for young children for that.
And I imagine a facility this size couldn't operate without volunteers.
Right, right. We have a good base of volunteers, approximately 350, 400 volunteers, and last year they logged in 8,500 volunteer hours.
And what about the staff size? Because that's a lot of volunteer hours. Somebody's got to manage those folks or help mm-hmm. point them in the right direction.
Mm-hmm. We have three staff. We have a full-time grounds person, and the other staff is an office person, that Robin Goldman, who does all of our events, and she organizes all of those fundraisers. And then we have the rest of it is myself as director part-time and as head gardener the rest of the time. And the rest is just all volunteers. We have just a great nucleus of volunteers that really make it happen.
Excellent. Now, I imagine part of the difficulty in a small venue like this is fundraising mm-hmm. and getting out there. Do you all get grants or financial assistance from the cities or counties?
We have gotten grants. We've got a grant from the TDC for the building that we've built in the Bonsai Pavilion. We created a whole garden in there to display 100 bonsai trees from a bonsai master. And we've got some other grants, educational mostly, in the past.
Right. Now, what about the annual admission costs? I know there's a daily admission, but family, I think there's a sale right now on family memberships.
There
I just
is.
Got something in the mail.
Yeah, there is a sale right now. Most of the time, an individual membership is $35. Mm-hmm. Family membership starts at $50, and then it goes on up. $100 is contributing, and it goes up to $500. And mostly what you get is free admissions to almost everything that we have, discounts in the gift shop, and discounts on educational programs.
Yeah. And since you mentioned the gift shop, that's another fundraising tool for the mm-hmm. The gardens. You've got some great, unique things here. It's grown by some local folks, too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we have the gift shop is run all by volunteers. We have a lady who orders all the inventory, does all the pricing. Another lady who organizes all the volunteers for the gift shop. And so the whole gift shop is run strictly from volunteers.
Now, I don't want to give too much away here, but what would people find in here? Obviously, a lot of native plants.
We have two native plant areas. One has become in the shade now because originally it was not in the shade, but the oak trees have gotten so big. And then we've got another area in our field that's strictly natives that love sun.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And the volunteer opportunities for folks to come in here. You mentioned the gift shop, and special help with special events. But mm-hmm. is there an opportunity for volunteers to come in and just help pull weeds?
Oh yes, every Wednesday morning from 9 to 12. That's when all of the volunteers show up for the grounds. So we do everything from planting to weeding to trimming.
And folks can find out more about that. I assume you have a website.
We have a website. Yes, we do. It's www.heathcotebotanicalgardens.org. And all the volunteer opportunities are on there, too.
And what about you are a year-round facility. You guys even open through the hot summer months, right?
I believe it's May, we close on Sundays. But now, in this season, we're open from November to May, Tuesday through Saturday, 9 to 5, and Sunday, 1 to 5.
Great. Now, what about special events? If folks want to come in, I know it's available for rent because I've come in here and seen people getting ready for their weddings because mm-hmm. it's a great backdrop.
Mm-hmm. We have a lot of facility rentals. We usually have a waiting list of people trying to rent the facility specifically for weddings. And you can look at our website, too. There's a lot of photos there. It shows you different garden rooms and places that you can get married. And the facility rental information, the prices and all that are on our website.
And have you ever done birthday party, like kids' birthday
mm-hmm.
parties?
We've had
too?
Birthday parties
okay.
too. Yeah, different
I think
things.
That'd be a cool opportunity for kids to mm-hmm. sit down and maybe do some plantings or
mm-hmm.
Because mm-hmm. Especially with younger kids, you got to keep them busy. You don't want to tear the house apart. They can come out here and get wild.
Yeah.
Not that they tear the gardens apart.
Oh no, they're pretty good.
A public gardens like this, why is it important for folks? I mean, there are plenty of parks and plenty of nature preserves, but give us a reason why folks should come out to public gardens.
It's a green space, which now has become very popular that we preserve our green spaces. Eventually, this will probably have sidewalks connected to the Savannah Preserve, that people can come in here and go over there. And the other thing, Heathcote's motto is to educate and inspire. So we like to be an educational tool for people to see what they could possibly do in their own gardens at
Absolutely,
home.
Absolutely, yeah. Yeah, and I know my wife's gotten some great ideas from some of the events here.
Mm-hmm.
Now, when I noticed some little visitors walking around, some four-legged friends. So the Heathcote, how did they end up here?
We had a litter of cats that were born here under the house, litter of five, and those cats are now over 10 years old. There's still four of them that still live here.
Oh, wow.
And then every now and then we do get other feral cats come in, and we try to catch them and take them to a vet and get them adopted. And if they can't get adopted, we'll usually let them stay here.
Yeah, they're not escapees from the.
It could be. I don't know. I don't know.
But I think that was kind of the thought at one point, the tie-in with the expansion and the Humane Society down the road. But, you know, so, like you said, maybe the sidewalks will connect.
I'm sure they will eventually, yeah. They'll have something that connects us over to there. We were involved with that in the beginning development stages of it. We were consulted with the landscape architects that they hired. So we were in the beginning stages in that aspect as a consultant.
Yeah.
But now that it's under construction, we're not anymore.
Well, in addition to the cats you have living here, I see some blue jays just swooping down behind us. What kind of birds and wildlife that drift in and out of the garden?
We have a lot of birds. We actually had some red shoulder hawks that had a nest here this year. They're not here anymore now, but they were several of them in our field area and in a pioneer field area. We've got hummingbirds. Those are here now. I've already seen some of them. Painted buntings. Mockingbirds, and then we have other critters like the raccoons and possums, and we even have a bufo frog.
Imagine that's why there's no koi in the ponds, right?
Yeah,
because the raccoons will get them.
Plus, they've heard that the herons will try to get them and poke. That's a liner in that pond. Poke a hole in the liner.
So you got to be careful of that ecological balance, right? Imagine the same way with plants. You have to be careful in what you plant because it may take over the canopy and hurt other plants that are in that garden.
Yep. Yeah. We try to look into that. The other thing we had was we have gopher turtles here also.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Great. Excellent. All right. Well, Miriam, we're going to take a quick break. When we come back, I want to talk more about the Christmas event that you guys have coming
up.
Okay. All right.
Sounds good.
Thanks so much.
Thank you.
Don't go anywhere. We're going to take a quick break. When we come back, we're going to learn more about Heathcote's upcoming Garden of Lights event. Welcome back to Postcards from Home. I'm your host, Erick Gill, and I'm joined by Tom, one of the volunteers here at Heathcote Gardens. Tom, tell us a little bit about this Christmas display that I understand you've been working on.
Erick, this is going to be the most innovative Christmas display east of the Mississippi River.
Nice.
As you can see, as a garden, the flowers are now lights. No one else does that. I must admit we copy somebody from the West Coast, but we've added our own touches with the Florida type of plants. Walk this way, One of the more innovative things we're going to have here in the great lawn is this will become a pond.
Oh, wow.
With cattails and other flowers. There'll be a swan that's lit up. Again, incredibly innovative. We have other trees that will be wrapped. We will have a potter's bench. That you have to see, the potter's bench, the gals, Nancy back there, she and Pam did that. It's incredibly, it's what a potter does.
You know,
here's the various things, and she's getting ready to plant these things, but they're all made out of lights.
Oh, wow.
And you have to see how intense they work, because every light has a zip tie on it. We've gone through well over 25,000 zip ties. Every light is zipped. As you can see there, we try to be creative. Other areas we're having are for the children. We're going to have a Santa's Village, and we believe Santa is coming us one weekend. I won't announce it just yet.
They can check the website for more details.
Absolutely. In the bonsai garden, we're doing a concept. You have 100 trees that are fundamentally the same thing. And the thought occurred to us that Monet painted a cathedral in France 30 times. The exact same picture, but with different color. So we're highlighting different colors and different aspects of the bonsai. See what color does to the same things.
Yeah.
we have what we're calling the bed bed. It's a little whimsical thing. It's a flower bed in a bed. And if you don't get a little belly laugh out of that, there's something wrong with you. We have Treasure Coast Way, which will be back and behind the cameraman here. And there be treasure there, mate. We guarantee it. Nice. We are the Treasure Coast, of course. And just another other little quirky things. We have Happy Cat and Sad Cat. Happy Cat will have a present, and Sad Cat doesn't. Maybe a lump of coal, who knows.
Now, event like this, Miriam talked a little bit earlier about the number of volunteers that go into putting on in a, you know, just on an annual basis, but imagine a specific thing like this takes an enormous amount of volunteer hours, but also sponsorships too. I understand Bud and Dot Adams are the main sponsors of this.
They're the naming sponsors. I am not the fellow who got involved with choosing
sure.
sponsors. In terms of volunteer hours, because it's the first year, we have over 3,000 volunteer hours wow. as of today.
Wow.
And we're, 10 days away from opening, so there'll be a lot more.
Yeah.
It's a funny thing, the iron law of projects is that the first 90% of the project takes 90% of the time. And the last 10% of the project takes the other 90% of the time. And that's where we are right now.
Sure. And then the activities, I know Miriam talked to me a little bit off camera too. There's going to be choral groups. You mentioned some of the lights and stuff, but there are also community involvement
yes.
as well.
That, again, I'm not been involved
sure.
in. What I can tell you I've been involved in, it's going to be one of the most fascinating and fun selfie events. We have Heathcote the bear. Heathcote is 8 feet tall. He is a polar bear. He's great big, 6 foot wide, and a whole family can get on him. There's places for them to sit and pose, and they can take their own selfie, or we'll take it for them, free of charge, and they'll be able to post it online or on Facebook, Heathcote Garden of Lights, or Heathcote Botanical Gardens, either one.
The only thing we need now is the cooler weather to make it feel like Christmas.
we're going to hang some dripping icicles.
Okay.
Nice. We have actually a young lady's here today. She's beginning that process.
Awesome.
So by this time next week, come by this time next week when we put this lawn together,
yeah.
we put the pond together, it will be intense.
How long does this event run through till after the new year? Or?
It's 6 weeks.
Six
weekends beginning Thanksgiving weekend, and then we will run 6 weekends, Friday and Saturday night through New Year's. Okay. Now, if thousands and thousands of people come and demand we stay another week or three, we can talk.
Sure. Maybe next year we get FPNL to sponsor with the energy bill, right? Or FPUA.
So. We hope so. And you know, we're always this is a fundraising event for
the community
garden,
yeah.
and it's something to build Fort Pierce again. Fort Pierce is building; they're coming back. It's a very vibrant community. You go down to our waterfront; you're seeing more and more things. More and more restaurants are opening. Sunrise Theater, just fabulous programs. And this, I think, will become the Treasure Coast Holiday Illumination event because of our uniqueness.
And it's so beautiful during the day. I can't imagine once it's lit up with all these wonderful lights, you know, it's that icing on the cake.
We're calling it Oz.
Oz, excellent. Well, I know you guys got a lot of work to do, so I appreciate you taking the time. And
thank you for coming.
All right, great. If you're looking for a great place to get into the holiday spirit or just reconnect with nature, then check out Heathcote Botanical Gardens. With a variety of monthly and annual activities, there are more than a dozen different areas and exhibits inside Heathcote. And you don't want to miss the James J. Smith Bonsai Gallery featuring more than 100 beautiful bonsais. Heathcote Botanical Gardens is open year-round, Tuesdays through Saturdays from 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. From November to April, it's also open on Sundays from 1 to 5 p.m. Admission into Heathcote is $6 for adults, $5 for seniors, and $2 for children. However, members and children are admitted for free. If you want to find out more about Heathcote's Garden of Lights, or to find out more about volunteering here at the gardens, Give the staff a call at 772-464-4672 or visit their website at heathcotebotanicalgardens.org. And if you'd like to see previously aired episodes of Postcards from Home, visit our YouTube channel at youtube.com/stlucygov. I'm your host, Erick Gill. Thanks for watching, and be sure to tune in again next month as we continue to send out Postcards from Home.